Now, look at that. That is the S&P 500 over the course of the last 3 years, since mid to late 2011. The S&P 500 has been in a massive secular bull market, and you could even call that a big uptrend channel on the S&P 500. It's an incredibly strong bull run on that. But you could also argue that within that, there are sequences of what we've got at the moment, which is a sideways trend, which is n no real direction. And that is pretty much your secondary trend or medium-term trend, sort of lasting a couple of months or so. S&P 500 has basically gone nowhere, like traded up and down, nowhere in those in that time. And within that also, if you zoom in a little bit more, you've got this sequence of a 1 to 2 week downtrend, which is then subsequently broken. So there are basically short, medium, and long-term trends within all charts, and you need to decipher exactly where you're trading within that macro trend. I think you do a top-down analysis personally. I think you decipher the big macro trend, and then you go inside that. So you realize that the S&P 500 is in this massive bull market, still is. But in the last 2 months or so, in the last 6 weeks to 2 months, it's basically going sideways, and it keeps hitting its head and sort of not really being able to go anywhere. There's no real trend going on in the course of the past 2 or 3 months on the S&P 500. But within that, then you've got this sequence of sort of uptrends and downtrends where the S&P 500 sort of rallies for a week or so and then falls away for a week or so. And that, in this period here, for example, falling away forms a nice downtrend, but that downtrend gets broken, and then subsequently you're back within this whole sequence of sideways trading. But what I would say is this is still suggesting that ultimately the S&P 500 will be continuing to move higher because it's in this massive bull market. It can still it I could still see the S&P 500 correcting back to 1920. So from 2046 down to 1920, that's 120 pips, 120 points, which is about 5-6%, 6%. You could still have that correction within this big bull market and still get away with it and still consider the S&P 500 to be in a bull market. So that is important thing to stress. Now, the other important thing to stress is that equity markets, and I think forex markets, sort of have different aspects of short, medium, long term. I think across equity markets, you can say probably between 1 and 2 years is where your bull market is, sorry, is where your long-term trend is. Maybe 6 months for a medium-term trend, so well, maybe between 3 and 6 months, and then a short-term trend, maybe a month. But in forex markets, there is a difference, which I'll show you now. I think that what you're seeing in forex markets is trends, because forex markets are zero-sum game. You don't really see massive secular bull markets or bear markets. You see sort of sequences of, annoyingly, the chart's not responding. You see a sequence of maybe 6 months or so in the big runs before maybe being retraced, and it is fairly evident that I think in this current sequence, oh, good Lord, in this current sequence of the euro, that we're in this n another sequence of big trend to the downside. We had this big throughout 2011 to 2012. We had this big bear market that was then reversed. You could even argue that there was a bull market there. In fact, it probably is. And then that was subsequently broken, and we're now seeing the reverse of that. We're now seeing the reverse of that. So we're seeing that the euro is in this big sell-off bear market. But within that, you've actually accelerated this downtrend at the moment. And I'll zoom in slightly here to show you we've accelerated away from that downtrend. And we've now broken that downtrend, which is interesting. And I think what we need to What we need to sort of see is that we're still in this big bear phase because we've still got this big downtrend here, and that downtrend doesn't actually come in until 121, 122 area at the moment. And that is important to know. Okay, right, a question. When do we know that the trend has changed? Good question. I'll tell you why. Okay, it's because you look for key highs and key lows. Now see this euro bull run from Q3 2012 up to 2014. You've seen a sequence of key higher lows that come in. First one was here. That never got broken, and then you had this key reaction high that subsequently was broken to the upside, and then you see the sequence of higher lows. Now, as soon as you start to see these sequence of higher lows broken, you start to think there's a possible trend reversal. You've also got a top pattern here, which actually forms head and shoulders top, but that's sort of looking at pattern analysis, but still, you've seen this key reaction low at 34.80, which breaks down. You also see this trend line being broken, and you start to see lower highs forming. So instead of seeing a sequence of higher highs and higher lows, you're seeing that sequence subsequently broken. And that is where I think around here, and obviously I was talking about this big head and shoulders top when it came around, and it was a very significant moment when that broke down, because it broke quite sharply down. And then you subsequently saw another lower high broken. Sorry, higher low broken, which was this one here back from Q4 2013. And on the breakdown of that, that is, I think, the confirmation of that big trend line break, that big trend line which lasted from Q3 2012 to 2014. You actually had 2 years worth of that bull run, but you saw that trend line broken, and subsequently there was a reversal of that trend, and we're now currently in this big bear phase. Okay, so how do you plot trend lines is the question. Now, as I said, you look for your key highs and your key lows, and you look in a bull uptrend, you're looking for connecting your key lows. And across this one, if I roll back, you can see this one here. You actually almost got a pretty good downtrend channel, actually. So if I leave that trend line there and draw in that one again, rehash that slightly, you've actually got a pretty good downtrend channel there. So you're looking to link your key highs and in a downtrend. And if you even can make a downtrend channel, you're looking for key lows to be linked as well. But just to bear in mind that you can do it in a different way. You can either use closing prices, which sort of takes out the noise of your high-low spikes, or you can use your absolute highs and absolute lows for your trend lines. But make sure you're fairly consistent in it, and it's very interesting to see. Okay, let's show you cable, because there's another one that I wanted to show you on cable. Interesting, right, okay. See, this one was cable, Q3 2013. You actually saw the trend line broken here, and this is sort of takes me back to that discussion we just had, really, about how you decipher trends, and when we build trends, you're looking for breakouts, you're looking for higher highs and higher lows. Now, you had this trend line forming through Q3 2013, zoom in slightly there so you can see a bit better, but it was broken. However, subsequently you saw the support coming in, and subsequently you broke out, and look at this breakout, because this move that you saw, actually I'll do it with horizontal, you saw this resistance broken at 63 figure. And subsequently, that resistance was broken. Now, anyone who sort of who was on my support and resistance webinar last month will know that that is a significant move, because you've broken up to a new high. So you're starting to build a new trend, but also you see these consistent moves back towards the breakout levels to find support and then go again. So you know throughout this period here that you're beginning to build a new trend. So you start to move higher, and you move higher consistently across the course of the next, 8 to 12 months. But then you start to see this breakdown, and the breakdown you see on cable, again, is when you see it move below this key higher low.